What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In our previous videos, we covered what graphs are, how many types of graphs we have, and we've learned a few graph traversal algorithms and techniques. Today we'll be focusing on cyclic graphs, both directed and undirected. More specifically, we'll try to see how to detect, encode, if any of these graph types contains a cycle. Let's first start off with directed graphs. And if you remember from our graphs introductory video, directed graphs are graphs where edges go in one direction. Here's an example. Notice how every edge is pointing in one direction from a vertex to another? Okay, now let's talk cycles. When you say cycle, think circles. Take a look at this graph for example. Here we can say that path A, B, C, D is a cycle. So basically, for a graph to have a cycle, there needs to be at least one path in which we can travel down and return to our starting point or vertex. If the graph contains one such path, then it is considered cyclic. In this case, we have a directed cyclic graph. Great! Now that we went through that refresher, let's see how we can determine if a graph contains a cycle. Determining a cycle is pretty straightforward. As we explore a path, if at some point we circle back to a vertex in that path before we finished exploring the entire path, then we have detected a cycle. Let me illustrate what I just said. And to do that, take this graph as an example. We can see that this graph indeed has a cycle, CDB. In order to show that this cycle exists, we'll use a variation of the depth first search traversal algorithm we previously covered. So, we'll keep going down a path until we either reach a vertex with no neighbors or come back to a vertex that's in our path. Assuming that we're starting at A, let's do a DFS and use green to indicate our current path, so any vertex that's colored in green indicates that it's on the current path we're traversing. Okay, the first child of A is E, and as we hit E, we see that we've reached a dead end on this path because E doesn't have any edges that point out of it. So, we mark E in blue, meaning that the entire path from our current vertex leading to E has been visited. There is no other way we can come back to E. And then, retrace back to the next neighbor of A, which is C. Notice how A is still green. That's because we haven't finished exploring all the paths from A. So, now we are at C, and we see that it has a neighbor, D. Here, D is still not a dead end, as it also has neighbors of its own, in this case, vertex B. Let's hop on to vertex B and mark it in green. Now, when we go ahead and visit the neighbors of B, we'll see that one of these neighbors is C, which is already marked in green to signal that it's on our current path. And since we came back to it, we know that we have found a cycle. The thing I want to stress is that any vertex that has been marked as visited, which is blue in this example, means that we've explored every path from that vertex. We are sure that we will never encounter this vertex again, no matter the path we pick. Because of that, we can assume that when we come across a visited vertex, we can ignore it, as we already know that there is no cycle linked to it. Okay, let's go ahead now and try to implement the logic we just saw. The first thing we'll need is the famous vertex class. This one, as usual, will host a data field, a list of vertices where the neighbors of this vertex will sit, and optionally, a helper method that allows us to easily add new neighbors to this vertex. Now, the two extra booleans we will need here are visited and being visited. To compare them to our previous example, being visited is the green mark and visited is the blue mark. So, when a vertex is marked as being visited, it means that the path we are currently traversing goes through that vertex. And when a vertex is marked as visited, it means that we've visited all the paths going through this vertex without finding any cycle. Okay, let's tackle now the hasCycle method. This one will take a single vertex as parameter, our entry point, and will return a boolean which specifies if the graph connected by the source vertex is cyclic or not. The first thing we did back in our example was mark A, or the vertex we started with, as green, meaning that we started exploring the paths that go through this vertex. To reflect this in code, we'll set the source vertex we have as being visited. So, while this vertex is being visited, we have to traverse all its neighbors, which represent the paths connected to this vertex, and check if they connect to a cycle somehow. If any of these neighbors leads to a cycle, then this method will return true. However, if none of the paths going through this vertex is part of a cycle, It means that we are done visiting this vertex and we can safely mark it in blue, meaning we can safely say that this vertex was visited from all its paths. You may have noticed how I left out this if condition blank. Let's fill it now. How are we going to check if that neighbor leads to a cycle? Well, as we mentioned, if that neighbor is also being visited, so we are visiting the source vertex here, but while doing that, if its neighbor is also being visited, it means that we ran into a cycle. And to invoke the DFS algorithm and keep going deeper into the graph, we will need to call the same method recursively to traverse the neighbors of each neighbor. But this is done only if the current vertex at hand is not visited, because if it is, then we already traversed all the paths going through it, and we are sure that it is not part of a cycle. Now, if all the vertices were traversed and were set to visited without entering in the if condition, then we can return false, meaning that our graph is acyclical. Okay, so far this implementation will work on most of the directed graphs you throw at it. But what if we had a graph similar to the one you see in front of you? You see, this one is a disconnected directed graph. And if we were to pass to our implementation the vertex A, it will return false, even though we can clearly see that it contains a cycle, CDB. So how do we fix this? To do that, we will have to call this code from a parent method that takes as input a list of all our vertices representing our graph. Then, for each unvisited vertex, we will have to call the recursive method we implemented. So, to simulate our previous example, the first vertex this for loop will process is A. After the first iteration, all the vertices you see in blue will be marked as visited. Then the for loop will keep going until it reaches vertex B, which is still unvisited, and at this point our code will detect the cycle. Now, before moving on to undirected graphs, let's test our code. To do that, I created a small main in which I initialized several vertices, and with the help of the addNeighbor method, I linked them to simulate the graph you see in front of you. As expected, when we call our method, it will return true. Okay, concerning undirected graphs, I will directly move to the implementation, as it is very similar to the directed ones, with a little twist. The parent method that takes care of the disconnected graphs case is exactly the same as the one we had. The only difference is that the recursive method it calls, and the one we are going to implement in a moment, takes two arguments instead of one. And the starting value of this argument is null, as you can see. Now, what is this second argument? In the parameters of the method, I named it caller. Why is that? Well, the additional use case we need to take care of in undirected graphs that isn't present in directed graphs is that if A and B are connected, we do not have a cycle. So, in directed graphs, that is a cycle. In undirected graphs, that isn't a cycle. These are just two connected vertices. And to identify this condition, we need to keep track of the caller vertex. So, if A is a neighbor of B and B is a neighbor of A, and we are visiting B from A or vice versa, we need to keep on going as we don't have a cycle here. Now, in code we'll have a very similar method to the one we had. The difference mainly lies in the condition of the if statement. The second part of the if statement is pretty straightforward and similar to what we saw with directed graphs. It lets us traverse recursively the remaining vertices of the graph. However, instead of only passing in the neighbor vertex to the recursive call, we will also need to pass the vertex it is being called from, which is the vertex that initialized the call of this method. Okay, concerning the first part, and because we are not making use of the being visited field here, we will know if we encountered a vertex that is currently on our traversal path by simply checking if that vertex is visited. Additionally, we need to take care of the undirected graphs condition we previously mentioned. So, it won't be enough to check if the neighbor vertex is visited, but that vertex will also have to be different from the caller vertex. Now, if we go ahead, create a small main, initialize vertices, and simulate the undirected graph you see in front of you by adding neighbors to these vertices, you'll see that the result is true, meaning we do have a cycle. And if we run this method against this second example, it will return false as expected. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.